side am I on? What side am I supposed to be on? I never know. Up tonight? How's everybody doing? Everybody ready to go tonight? I sat down and put a heating pad on my knee and I just went out and I was like, oh my God, what time is it? And so, you know, you get that, man, the naps are horrible to me. I don't know if anybody else. I didn't plan on taking a nap. I didn't plan on closing my eyes. I didn't plan on it, but it happened. Maria D, buenos tardes a todos. If buenos tardes means late, I was not late tonight. It sounds like that would be Tardos. But yeah, so I just like went, oh my, and then you have that fear, that panic of year later, you're going to be late and you're like, oh my God. And I still had 15 minutes, but I still was a little bit whacked out. Don Barry. That's not my beautiful wife. That's Talking Heads. Stop Making Sense. I think, AH Tom is all here. I don't see Tom on here, but I see Luffy Pirate, AH, Don Barry, Maria D, Ryan, and AH. I don't see Tom. Tom might be, he's going to be possessed by the Suns game tonight, I'm sure. And so that definitely, he doesn't usually miss. So maybe he's tardies as tardis. A good evening to everybody. Good vibes. I'm glad everybody's having hopefully a good day today. You know, the weather has really still been pretty good. It's starting to warm up. We might slip in a little bit under the wire for a little more awesome adventures. Spent some time searching for the mysterious cave on the magical map that we had, that we followed up from last week, and we did that. So we had that action going on. You're going to get to see me pull out not only one Chola, but two. I think there was actually three. It's a bloody mess when I was done. And then you'll see that tonight. And then next week you'll see the bike ride from hell. And it was absolutely the bike ride from hell. There's no doubt about that. I know it's real as long as the treasure cave is marked. Absolutely. And I think it was. The X might have been on my leg, might have been my Chola. But I did a little what they call desert piercings. I had a couple desert piercings. And, you know, that still hurt. And I don't know how in the hell they jumped on my leg. I really don't. Maybe that's why they're jumping, Chola, because they do jump. You know, I was thinking about something, and I wanted to throw this out, you know, because we still have a lot of people that are so leery of the fact that you should go into any location or any area and, you know, don't touch anything. And you know, we definitely should follow the rules of making sure that we take care of these resources. Absolutely. 110% behind it. Believe in it. And, but, you know, I was looking at an article today, and, it was like, I'll throw it up real quick. Let me throw this article up real quick and let me see if anybody else even has ever heard of this happening. Have you ever heard of this right here? Woolly mammoth fossil found in Chandler 20 years ago this July. On July 3rd, 1997, officials of the city of Chandler, Arizona, were alerted that the fossil of a woolly mammoth had been found in the Phoenix suburb. The Chandler Museum looked back on the stunning discovery with an article Tuesday explaining the remains of Ice Age creature found in the newly dug sewer ditch. Never heard of that ever. Never, ever heard of there being a woolly mammoth on Chandler / Gilbert. And so I'm going to dig a little deeper into that, but it was like, you know, if we're digging a new condominium, or we're digging a new highway, whatever the new construction might be, because if you'll notice now, we have more warehouses anywhere in the world. They're going up unbelievably. And so there's going to be everything being dug up, turned up, turned over. So if they dig up an ancient, let's say it's an ancient cemetery by chance, you know, maybe even Pioneer, right? That may, doesn't have to be super ancient, right? And they didn't know about it. And they start to dig it up. What do you do with it? You know, do you stop, you know, do you stop all the construction? Do you shut the highway down? Do you divert the highway? Do you divert the building? What do you do? Right. What is the proper way? Because, you know, we get so sideways that nobody's supposed to see anything, but then when other sources get these same locations and find them, whether it be widening the 17 or whatever it might be. Like I said, if you've seen the amount of warehouses that are being constructed in the state of Arizona, and you'll also notice the fact that if there ever was a time that we're going to run out of water, it's going to be coming. And nobody seems to give a shit about that. And that's my own personal opinion. Threw a little barb in there. But you know, they're digging up everything. And so there's stuff being found on a regular basis. So what do you do? What is the rules of engagement? Not what they should do as far as what the government says they should do, but what do you guys think about when it comes down to what do you do? Is what's morally right? I mean, we say don't go to these places. We say don't touch stuff. We don't look at it. We dig it up. We throw it in a bag. Most contractors probably hide it or say they, you know, don't tell anybody you've seen it so we can keep digging. And I get their side of it too. Don't get me wrong, but it kind of makes that whole engagement of don't touch it, don't see it, don't look at it a little weird. When the highway comes in, they see it, they touch it, they dig it up, they put it in the back of a dump truck and they haul it off. And so, you know, it's crazy. And the fact that there were woolly mammoths in Chandler fascinates me. But, you know, how many times do they dig up stuff? You know, I know when they dug up the and then the other side of the coin is, I mean, you can't put all of it in a museum. You can't make all of it a location. You can't make all of it a site where people should go and see it. Can you or can you? Because that kind of is an argument when it comes down to the fact that what is the right and wrong thing to do morally. I'm not talking about law, what the law says you should do. I'm saying, you know, the same people that say do not put up a fence also are the same people that put up a fence. So how does those, you know, the balance and what that happens when that stuff goes on. I'm just curious to what your guys' thought process is, because it really is kind of strange. And again, should we maintain this stuff? Should we take care of it? Absolutely. What do you do? How many pots can you stuff in a warehouse in Tucson, Arizona, at the University of Arizona? And that's not a knock on them. I mean, what they get the stuff, they put it somewhere. They can't display all of it. What do they do with it? They put it in the back, may even take a few pieces home. That looks good on the shelf, even though maybe that, you know, I mean, you can't say that's never happened, because part of what this mystery that we found this cave, and this is the cave on the map with the pots, right? So when they found this thing, it had pots in it. And so, and the story goes that they gave them over to the crooked politicians, is what the article says. And the crooked politicians made them go away. And whether that's true or not true. So if you found precious pots, who do you call? How do you know it gets taken care of? What do you do when that does happen? Do I believe that there's still mysteries and histories and all that cool stuff out there today for you and I to find? Absolutely, there is. I will tell you, there is, and there are being things discovered on a monthly basis in the state of Arizona, especially with the construction that's going on. And out there, if you do enough history and a lot of mystery, and you dig up these stories and you dig up this stuff, you will find stuff out there. And we're going to get into every week going in and looking back at an archaeologist that maybe made a big impact in the state of Arizona. And you guys know that I have a couple different guys that are out there that I kind of looked up to, Malcolm Rogers being one. I didn't look up to him morally for how good a husband and maybe a father he was, even though I shouldn't judge that. I just know what the article says. But he did excavate all of Arizona, a lot of California. He was the president of the, they don't call it now the Museum of Man. They call it the Museum of People. I think they call it that now. But he did, and he took a lot of stuff out of Arizona. He took a lot of stuff out of everywhere that, and put them in this museum. And we talked about that a little bit, but, you know, it's funny that if you know our history and you know that people were digging sites legally, what, up to the 60s, 65, what was it? You know, they were pot hunting legally, you know, legally. And so when people say don't touch stuff, you know, it's kind of a little late. I mean, and don't get me wrong. The scary part is there is so much stuff in Arizona that you still can go out and find things. I choose that, you know, I just think morally it's the right thing to do to leave them put. I don't probably think everybody thinks that, but I do personally. I believe that as a channel, that's what we have a responsibility to do. The cool thing to me is that whatever I might find, I'd want somebody else behind me to find it. And I don't want them to take it either. I want them to leave it there. So then the next guy can find it and the next gal can find it and they can have that same experience that I had. And how cool that is when you get to do that and you get to go to the locations and you get to find this stuff. I just think it's good. I just think it's a good deal to do it. And also realize that these are cemeteries. I mean, how would you treat your cemetery in your hometown, wherever that might be? What would you do? How would you do that? Would you go by and, you know, haul stuff off and chip tombstones for James Dean or whoever it might be? Well, yeah, some people did that. But you know what? What are you? You know, it's just whatever morals that you think you have. I just think it's just good. It's just good to leave that stuff alone, and everybody get something they find. They go, "Wow, that's pretty cool." I understand that. You know, I do understand that. Let's go down the list real quick and see where we're at. Don says there are a lot of places that, if possible, you need to let someone take a look. It's different if it's human remains. That needs direct First Nations involvement. Ghost tape number 9. First Nations are the first to your knowledge. Don Barry, our local desert has mammoths, camels, saber-tooth, and even horses. That's interesting you should say that because you kind of must be reading my mind. There's a tiny museum in Welton that has a mastodon bone. And, you know, when you look back and you think about this, when you went down to a cave that we would talk about, you know, we're also going to kind of look at a different area every week and kind of just throw some stuff down an area that maybe there's Luffy Pirate and just throw out an area that's out there that people might or might not know about and just throw it out there and see what's out there. I will say this. I talked to a gentleman today out in Nevada and he goes out and he does a lot of stuff and we chat on a regular basis. And I say regular, monthly, or every month and a half, whatever. But I have a lot of respect for what he does and how he does it. And we talked about, you know, getting out and doing things. And I believe that we have a responsibility to be able to show people what's out there. And the fact is that you know, if you don't go see this stuff soon, it will be shut down and it will be closed. There's forces already in nature already that are out there that are trying to shut this stuff down. And he talked about a location that he went to that, you know, 2 years ago, you could have went in, he could have done whatever he wanted to do as far as getting all the information, videotaping, whatever he wanted to do. And today it shut down, can't get in. And I'm not saying that, you know, and it's not always directly some government force. Sometimes it's personal individuals that, you know, whether that might be the cause of maybe they have had problems with people looting or tearing up their stuff or whatever it might be. People that aren't even associated with people that like to go find this stuff in the desert. But still, they've dealt with it. And so if there's places you want to go, you need to put them on your list and you need to get out there and do it. Because it is limited and the timing is limited, absolutely limited to do that. But I would tell you they're finding stuff on a monthly basis in the desert that is new and exciting. So it's still out there. It's still there. And if you do the history is critical when you do this stuff. I stumbled on a site that was a historical site. I did the research on this historical site, and then I found out that a lot more stuff went on in this location from reading the book that they talked about what happened with this group of people. And I won't get into depth with it, but it said, you know, it talked about how many people they had a lot of connections with Native Americans at that time. Now, this is not super ancient, but a couple hundred years. But still, it just shows to show you they were there. They were in this location. They were in the area that we were going anyway. So what's that tell me? It tells me that there's stuff there. I mean, it just is. I mean, they were there. It's dictating. And if you do that kind of research, what you'll find out is that there is stuff everywhere. So let's pull a section out of here. Let's look at it real quick. And this is just a random thing I thought about because I was looking for archaeologists that have made an impact in the state of Arizona and the Southwest. And I put about four of these guys up when I do this, but we're not going to talk about all of them. But when I looked at one, this definitely came up, and let's look at this real quick. There's a lot of different stuff about this. We'll go to this. We'll show you this one first, and we'll open that up because Hayden was one of the gentlemen that looked at this, but he was definitely not the only one. And there is in this specific cave, there was these horses that were in there. So you already start to understand how far back this was, because there was also sloths in this cave. It's funny that Don had talked about that, because all of a sudden in this specific cave was a lot of different stuff. And the cave is this cave here. It is the Ventana Cave. And this is the Ventana Cave. And if you'll look at some of these pictures on here, they're pretty spectacular. And it's pretty incredible to go through this and see what was there. And so where is the Ventana Cave? So this not being magic, this is not some magic deal. This is not some secret stuff. This cave specifically is not. Let's look into, let's get into Google Earth. And if you just search Ventana Cave, this comes up. And there's where we're at, right there. There's Oregon Pipes, Noida, Casa Grande, Maricopa, Florence, Morena, Tucson. So it is right here on the reservation right here. So the specific cave that they're talking about. So all I did was look up Hayden, and all of a sudden it started to pull the works that he had done up. And then it shows it. So all I had to do was search that. It pulled it up and it showed you exactly where it was at. It's right there. So you can do that with a lot of different stuff on how you're looking at what you're doing. So you can pull up any one of these different articles that you can look at these guys and you can go, wow, where the hell is that? Right? So in that cave, and I've got about 15 articles pulled up about that specific cave. That is a cave that Hayden believed that ancient man was here a lot longer than the normal 10 to 12,000 years when they looked at how old and how many things that were in there. And there was a lot of stuff in that cave. And so it's cool to me to do the searching. That's what I find fun. That's kind of funny. There's been a lot of weird stuff go on today, Ryan, about like there's a lot of weird wavelength stuff going on. I want to tell you this real quick. I've been looking for this specific book for a year and a half. John had a copy, right? And he had a copy of this book. And this was the Magic Purple Book, right? Of Perry Mesa. And we've been looking for this book for, I mean, years. And there are rare. And I had a guy call me and said, if you want the purple book, I know where there's one at. And I said, really? And he said, yeah, they're the purple book. I know where it's at. I get online, it's there. And I went, holy crap, the purple book. So I bought it. I'll be damned if I didn't call John like 45 minutes later. We talked 45 or 50 minutes. He had bought another copy of the purple book. How the hell is in the same like hour? And there were two available, and I don't know, there might be more, but I was like, holy crap. See, that book is the specific book that made me excited to go find the magic Ala Negra that you guys have seen. And so that research in these books are critical when you're doing that kind of work. Now, I'm going to let you in a double secret thing. And this is it's not double secret. I say it's double secret because nobody seems to know. But I'm going to tell you about some double secret stuff tonight. And is what we're going to talk about is, I only say double secret is because it's, you got to do the work, right? You have to go look at these books. You got to find these articles. You got to get in the middle and start digging in there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull this up because I find he was the guy I was going to do this story on. Boma was another guy I was going to do that did mainly all the stuff on the rock structures that are in his book that are also online. Let me pull this up real quick and I'll show you something that I was looking at which I found extremely strange. Where is this at? Oh, here it is, because it's a weird article. We're going to share this if you're ready to go. Now, probably the most famous guy that ever did any work in the state of Arizona is a gentleman that was named Malcolm Rogers. And he did work some of the most important work, in my opinion, in the state of Arizona. And so when you read this article, Malcolm Rogers, Arizona Fieldwork between 1926 and 1956, he talks about some stuff that is ridiculous. He talks about a cave that's 50 foot wide, okay? Ceilings covered with white, black, purplish red, hemolite red, and orange red pictographs. He talks about things in the state of Arizona that are spectacular. Imagine this cave right here. And if you could see this thing with all these colored pictographs all the way down, all these colors that he is describing. He's describing this stuff that he's seen and took pictures of in the state of Arizona. Okay. So, and he talks about this stuff and then he gives you a map, right? Now I've been to some of these locations in here and here, this area here, right? I think it was right there. I've been there. I think the 5 or 6, I'd have to go look and see what 5 and 6 is. But these are places. Now, this guy, if he shows you that he goes there, these are spectacular locations. These aren't like the run-of-the-mill stuff. This is not like half-ass stuff. This guy was the greatest archaeologist in the state of Arizona. This guy knew where more stuff was, dug more stuff up, probably took more stuff than anybody else. But so when he gives you like 8 or 9 locations in the state of Arizona, this is the elite stuff that's out there. Probably some of them you can't even get into, right? But if you look at these and he tells you where they are and you start doing the research and you start realizing that there's stuff out there in this category. Now, he does talk about some that have been caved in. And he couldn't get back in. It says right here on this one here, 1928, the roof of the cave of 2 directly east of 1 had fallen, so they rested on the crown of the occupational talus. In 1940, it was found that a cloud burst had completely destroyed site 2, contains flat matates and 1 ancient petroglyph. But if you look at this dude's work and you start doing the research and you start digging in to this cat, this guy was the dude, man. There is stuff out there that he has found. Now, I talked to an archaeologist that told me that he knew where this was. We were going to try to search this down. This was the Bowes Wash, which would be over by, where would it be? Kofa, down from Kofa. And you look at this stuff and you look at this work that this cat did. This is another guy that, man, if you want to be having adventures and you want to look at some of this stuff, there is some incredible, incredible stuff that are out there and pretty cool stuff. Hari is exactly who that guy is. Now, he set up a bunch of stuff and did a lot of stuff with a couple of the different guys at that time and did a lot of the digging. Now, from what I understand, he was more of a scholar and the other guys were basically more of a blue collar archaeologist, which is pretty cool. Jacob, what's up? Any validity to the rumors about hieroglyphs found in the Grand Canyon. You know, that's a great story. I don't know how true it is. It's a great story. I want to think it's accurate. I want to think it's real. I want to think it's right. But there's so many things that you can find out there if you just do the work. And a lot of people that I know in depth on this channel, they do the work and they find a lot of stuff because it's still out there. And again, if you want to see this stuff, man, the window is changing. Their window is changing. Look for Malcolm Rogers, Arizona field work. This will find the PDF. And that is, and again, he's just one of the guys. Hari is, not Hari, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but Hari, did a lot of stuff in the state of Arizona as well. A lot of people, when they talk about digging, Snake Town and stuff like that. So, and then this Ventina cave, that was all dug by them as well. And so you look at these locations and they're spectacular. And, you know, there's stuff just everywhere in the state. If you talk to anybody outside of the state that does stuff in Nevada or California and a lot of these places, and they have stuff, don't get me wrong, but not like we have here. That you do not have the amount of stuff that you have in this state anywhere in the United States. We have all of it. And again, you can go out by doing the research. So part of this story that we're going to this coming week or next week has to do with reading a historical document that had to do with people traveling from the East Coast to the West Coast and the Mesoamericans. And then he researched the people and it talks about, well, they had all these help from all these different groups of people that were here. And then you're like, well, if they had got all this help from all these groups, they had to be in the same area as this is, and on and on and on. And then you start putting two and two together and you start realizing, wait a minute, man, wait a minute. There is stuff here. There has to be. I mean, so you do that work and then you go out. The funnest things that I have ever done since I've been doing this channel is finding stuff. The time that we spent on the internet, the time we spent on Google Earth, the searches, all the different stuff, the chasing is the most fun stuff to do. And sometimes it's so frustrating, but man, when you find something you've been looking for a year, it's one of the coolest things that I have ever done. It's so gratifying. It's like, it's all that stuff, you know, Indiana Jones kind of stuff is not the jumping in and tearing down the temple. It's that work that you do when you find it and then you put boots on the ground, then you go out and you find the stuff. And it's incredible. If you're into that stuff, it's really incredible. But as much fun as that is, it's as much fun to me as to find it and do the research on that. There is Jacob Workman. What's up, Jacob Workman? Ryan talks along with my favorites. There it is. Arizona artifacts are in California. Roger loaded his truck with stuff left the excavation site, if I'm not mistaken. He took stuff from everywhere. But you know, that back in the era that, you know, that's just what you did. You just do the shit in the back of the truck and took it home. Wow, that's a nice pot, isn't it? Yeah, sure is. One for me, one for you. Have you not been many places, but I can attest that this everywhere I go here, the ditch to the wire. And again, you go out there, you look at something, you look at an article, you start doing the research, you look at a map, you look at a treasure map, and then what do you find on the treasure map? You find a location, you know, they didn't put it on there. Now, where in the hell is it at? Then you do the work to try to find it. You have a couple, you know, you get a couple leads here or there, and you go out and then you put boots on the ground to try to find it. And that's what makes this stuff so damn fun to me. It absolutely does. Let's have a group outing the Superstition Mountains at night and see what we find there. You found a lot of stuff at the Superstition Mountains at night. Superstition Mountain at night is one of my favorite places to be. It's weird. It's kind of scary, but it's cool. And you know, a lot of people go out there all the time. So it's not like some magical thing's going to happen, like some alien might get you, but that definitely, I would think, would be fun if it did. But there's a lot of stuff there. What's Don say? Better go right at sunset and let it get dark while you're there. The only problem I don't like about the Superstition Mountains at night, and this is just me personally, is they got a weird, their snakes are kind of weird. Everywhere else, snakes don't like laying the trail. But the Superstition Mountain, for some reason, I've had a couple situations where at it gets dark and they just, most snakes don't lay in the trail. And for some reason, I've had two occurrences out there where the snake's in the trail. I'm like, gosh, dang it. I mean, I'm glad they're in the trail versus not out there. But it's kind of like, I think rattlesnakes are some of the coolest animals out there. I don't want to get involved in that though. I really don't want to get into the snake deal. Ghost tape number 9. We all had someone talking to us on our deer hunt last November, Horrell Creek. That's crazy. That's great. I mean, I'm still going to tell you that that's a crazy. I was more uneasy in the Superstition Mountains than I was in the Apache Death Cave. Other than I felt that there were going to be serial killers running up and down 40. But I was more uneasy in Superstition Mountains than I was in the Apache Death Cave, to show you a little bit. So that's what's bizarre. And so, you know, there's been so many people wandering around out there in the dark. It's been unbelievable. So let's take a journey. This is a long intro, so you'll have to put up with it. I shortened it for next week, and we'll show a little bit of next week. But what we're going to do is I'm going to kick up this video a little bit. This is the journey to find the hidden cave. Not caves, but cave. And it's a pretty long video. So hold on and get ready. And here we go. On a journey today, we're doing a little bit of map work, right? So on the map that we saw, part of this map had the Nirvana Cave on it, and the cave is supposed to be across over that ridge line right over there. And we're going to take a look and see if we can't find it, see how, if we should have wore long pants or not. It does look horrible. We're going to get up over that ridge. Got a good breeze going, so you might have a little bit of audio that's jacked up, but it's going to be okay. I mean, people have spent their lives in the Superstition Mountains roaming around trying to find stuff, and it's kind of interesting when you go out here to think about the amount of time people spent out looking for treasures and, you know, how many people died out here in the whole nine yards. So we're going to get on that ridge. Now, this is supposed to be a place where they found a bunch of pots. And from what the article said was greedy, non-trustworthy Arizona politicians stole all these pots. Now, I can't say that that happened. I don't know what Art would think about that, but that's what they said. So, you know, I don't know. Beautiful out here today. This new park that they put out is ridiculous. It really is beautiful. We're going to take a look. I'm still having problems with the GPS not doing what it's supposed to do. But I'm going to probably just have to get another one, because I can't have this thing not telling me
where I'm supposed to be. We're gonna make our way. Well, we got pretty easy to hiking for Superstition Mountains. I'm not mad. So far, this has been a pretty easy trek. It might get worse up here, but right now you can't beat it. Well, the compass says we need to go up, so somewhere we need to go up. Let's go around that ridge, just see if we can get out of the way. Let's just take a walk. It's still fairly nice out. It's not hot yet. No. Just watch where you step.
It's nice out, the snakes are out.
And you're also trucking through nowhere land. If you hear a buzz, just freeze. $224. Ow. Oh, that hurt. Ooh, that one got me good. First blood of the day. Didn't even, boy, that wasn't one I would have thought would have got me. Okay, we're looking for two things. We're looking for a rock cropping. And we're looking for a wall.
You think it's on this side or on the other side?
I think it's over there.
Right up in there?
Yeah, I think it's over this. I think it's on that side. And I could be wrong, but... Oh. I bet a dollar he's got gators tomorrow. See anything over that lip? Well, you don't want that happening. Right there. That's not something you want happening. How'd that sucker get me? It got me all right. Okay, let's do the double rocks. I don't have a comb on me. Tell you what, that dude don't want to come out. This is called trailblazing. in the Superstition Mountains. That's what this is called. You know, it is kind of nice to have another guy on point down there, because I don't think it's up here, but I need to go up and see. Trail going up there. Found it. It's a good thing. You know, it sounds like the coordinates were right, but boy, you just can't trust these. When you can't trust your compass, man, that is a bad day, because then you don't trust the damn thing. So when you get in there, you don't believe it. That trail right there interests the hell out of me. I don't know how difficult that thing would be to get up to. And then what the hell is... It's like there's a little cave right up in there. What it looks like. You know, you hate going down and then you hate coming back up, but it's kind of like I said, you never know, you're probably never coming back, you know, and you're 3/4 of the way up. And there ever was a time that you might want to go ahead and do it, I would think this would probably be it. If you can get down. I'll at least get to that next ridge and call it after I get up there. Never gonna get back up here again. I'm trying to see if there's any petroglyphs or anything. I don't see anything. There's something over here, but I don't think there is. Thank you. God dang. Something got me. Here's another one. Damn it. Dudes, they're everywhere. That hurts. Hurt the first time. Look how deep those get. Every one of them hurt. I should have known how I did that. I knew how I did that. I wouldn't do it again. Jesus. That one surprised me. I don't know why I have to get over here and see this, because I just do. Be badass if I found something over here, though. Here's the rock crabbing. Don't see anything back here. But at least I checked. This is an ass busting waiting to happen. I can tell you that for sure. So don't want this trail to run me so that I have to go back up. Don't want to go back up. I want to go down, but not back up. Well, we'll give it a shot. Boy, this is kind of a treacherous trail here. Like I said, it's just waiting for you to bust your ass. I'd officially call this Ass Buster Trail. Well, coming across that ridge was not very easy. See what's up here. It's right down there. Says on here, I hear one of the natives. Oh, hell, look at that. You know, your average bear wasn't going to find that, Art.
your coordinate was right on. That was just using my phone, you know?
Well, I think I'll start using my phone instead of my stupid GPS. So somebody had a wood structure here at one time.
Have you seen that trail coming in here?
No.
There's a, people have been through here. There's a trail coming this way. There's one going out right there. Like they were tromping through there. Or something. Like.
See the fire? Ceiling?
There's stuff dripping back there. I don't know what that is.
Yeah, they had fires back here too. Look at this. This is incredible. Look at this. This thing's monstrous. Now, when they found this cave, they had all kinds of stuff. The thing was full of pots. So this is the famous cave from the map. Isn't this crazy?
Good place to hide out.
So this is actually extremely large. There are a few shards in here. We'll leave them be. Look at this thing. I tell you what, this is pretty spectacular. This is a big one. And look at that. You'd have never known by this little entry, would you?
It opens up.
Tell you what. It's been nice out of the, look at that thing. Isn't that incredible? Look at this old can. Did you see that can?
Yeah, there's a can and there's a couple pieces of glass in there.
Now remember on old tracks like this, if you guys haven't been in here, this is considered to be artifacts. So if you get old cans and stuff, leave them be. Because they're considered to be artifacts as well. So when you're looking through this stuff, man, definitely look through it. Hell, I touch it. Just leave it. Look at that cave, man. That's incredible. I never dreamed this thing was here. Holy crap. Well, for your first adventure, Art, what'd you think? So somehow they had something going on here with all this wood, this rock. Yeah, they trailed it in. Okay, let's go in. I don't know what these rocks, wood here, they had something built here at one time. I don't know what it was. When you go in here, you just don't believe that you're gonna get this. This is huge. Man, you just don't see them this big. Glass. This might be the end here. Look at this, isn't this incredible? Well, this is the famous pot cave right here. Incredible view. Pretty cool. Well, Art, we found it, so. We did what we were supposed to do today, didn't we?
Yeah, look at that view.
There is the famous, infamous pot cave right there. But now okay, so look at that. Double whammy.
Double whammy.
Okay.
It's all cut right through here. The flowers are still open.
Oh, yeah.
There it is, another one off the list, another journey taken, Make sure that if you go to these locations, please do so. Please go, you know, please document it. Please make sure that, you know, if something, I like the documentation to know how things are when different groups of people have seen them. I think it's important. I really do. But please make sure that you leave the stuff alone and you don't take anything and you, you know, leave it where it's where it be and allow somebody that comes in behind you to be able to have the same experience. I mean, nothing in there of any value or, you know, I mean, even if you would find something, leave it be, you know, leave it be. Definitely. But definitely enjoy it. And I think that's where our issue gets to be is there's a group of people that want you to tell you that you're not supposed to be there. You're not supposed to look at it. And I disagree with them, but I do agree with the fact that, you know, let's make sure that we take care of them. We have the coolest resources of any state, anywhere. We do. Stuff is everywhere. Adventure is everywhere. But please make sure that when you protect these places and then that you leave them being and you leave them as you found them. It's important because if you take any of that stuff, you get cursed and you will have demons in your bedroom and your walls will catch fire. I don't know if that's true or not. I kind of like to think that makes it easier to leave it there. If you are afraid that you have built a house on hallowed ground in the city of Phoenix, Arizona, I'm already going to tell you, you got a pretty good chance that you already did. Okay. Because if you live anywhere within Phoenix in Phoenix, and you've done any work on any of the maps, which a lot of you people have, cause you've given me a lot of stuff, you will realize that there are houses everywhere. There are ASU is built on ruins. I mean, the stuff is everywhere and there are great stories. You know, one of the things that I'm kind of disappointed is we then took a trip up to, we took a bike trip up to Agua Fria, and that will be next week. I'm going to show you just a piece of that just so you know what's coming. But we did a bike trip up to Lousy Fort, and it was the road to hell. I mean, that's what we called the video, is the road to hell, because I tell you what, that place is brutal. Giant spiders. I like this. Giant spiders will nest in your bed while you're sleeping. I agree. I like that. I like that idea. I like that idea, and it should be right. But like I said, leave the stuff alone. Let it be. Let it be for the next person that gets to see it. Make sure it's there for the next person, the next generation, the next children of the children of the children to be able to see this stuff. Go see it, because a lot of people believe that shutting it down is maintaining it and protecting it. I don't know who they're protecting it from. Definitely not people on this channel, and definitely not people on most of the channels that are explorers. And one day they'll realize that there is a difference between the groups. There's a difference between some of the people that go out in the desert, and there are a difference between the people that go out to seek and search history in the making, because that's really what you're looking at. I was going to tell you, you know, I was at the Lousy Fort, which is incredible, and I'll never go back there again. I don't believe, right? There are 9 locations at Lousy Fort and, or Lousy Canyon area. And, one thing that's very disappointed in our culture is that we don't have the history, because, you know, when you're looking at 200, 300, 400, 500 years, depending on where you're at and what you're doing, you know, that there were situations that happened in places like Agua Fria that would have been spectacular. And there were heroes and there were villains and there were groups and there were the good and there were the bad and there were the violent and there were there would be great wars. There would be great famine. There would be great diseases. I mean, everything that would have happened, it happened in everybody. And there would have been great stories at each and every one of the locations that are on Agua Fria. So anytime that you're up there and you're in the Kings or the warrior space of Pado, or you're anywhere in there, remember that the people that came before you and the people that walked before you had lives that they lived in those areas just as well. And the sad thing is, you know, as Don's saying, is that, you know, there was fabulous stories. You're up there in that one of the most incredible, not the, there's another fort that's probably cooler, that I haven't climbed the peak to find yet or to get to. I know where it's at, but, you know, haven't decided that that's the journey with the knee I've got. But they didn't build that for fun. Okay, that wasn't for fun. That wasn't a place they went and hung out at. It wasn't an all night club up there. They didn't build those walls and they didn't build that stuff because they thought it was fun. And so when people want to talk about, you know, the entire Agua Fria is built with line of sight. They knew who was coming in. They knew who was going out. They knew where they were at all times. They were there to protect themselves. And it would have been unbelievable. The history of that location would have been absolutely fabulous. Luffy Pirate is rather sleep with a snake over spiders. I don't, you know, that's a tough, depending on which snake, I don't know if I would go with that. I'd take a small spider bite. As you can see, I can take a little pain, even though, it's Smiley Chavez. No dance party is correct on that one. I'm going to show you a little bit of the videos that are coming next week. So you guys will be ready to go next week. We called it Road to Hell. And it was probably one of the most fun trips I've had. Riding those bikes in the desert is as rough as it was, is a absolute gas. You'll see the first intro, so don't fall asleep too quick. I shortened this one up. I'm not going to play but about 5 minutes of it, but this is what we will show next week.
Familiar with this landscape, you know where I'm at.
Bam, you know where I'm at. If you tune in next week, you'll be able to see the hell ride, and it was a hell ride. But it was really cool. It really was fun too. So if you tune in next week, you'll be able to see Lousy Fort, which is a journey in itself, as my friend Angelo would say. That's a long way back there. And he wasn't kidding. It was a long way on a bike, let alone if you were in a four wheel. It'd probably been 2 hours, I'm going to guess, to get back in to Lousy Canyon. I'm going to guess 2 hours. Me and John Maria went out there and some the ruin site, but we didn't get to the fort that day. And I thought about it also the last time that I was at that location, a couple of years ago, maybe, it was freezing cold. I had winter stuff on. Bikes need bigger tires. We need to spend a lot of time, Don, on air pressure too. Air pressure is a big deal. So we'll go from there. But that is all we have tonight for the show. We hope that you enjoyed it. I hope you had a good time. We will go more in depth next week. If you can do me a favor, please give me the thumbs up button at least. If it's all we can pull off tonight, please do so. And I would appreciate that sincerely. And man, that the next week's going to be a great show. Hopefully you're going to have a great week. And we're going somewhere else this week. Going to try to Friday, make a journey into the desert again with the bikes. Hopefully we'll have a good time. And Smiley Chavez, thank you very much. I appreciate everybody. There's Mr. Don Barry pulling me out. As always, Mr. Don Barry, that is much appreciated.
Can it be? Well, I think it is. Well, I'll be damned. That's Don Barry. Holy shit. You look good. I like that.
Boom, Don Barry, thank you very much. You're awesome, and I appreciate the love, and I appreciate the support, and I appreciate the help. We will be back next week. These shows, when are they going to be? You know what? The new thing that I'm doing, that ain't no shit. The icy hot, that's actually, I tell you what, my knee is like on fire. I'm going to tell myself a little bit before we get out of here. We rode these bikes, right? And I've ridden this bike 7-10 times before. It's not like the first time I ever got on the bike. You've seen videos but I've never been on the hay bike with really no suspension. And Art didn't have suspension on his bike either. They're pretty similar, kind of Chinese rockets. This road is so, when you see this next week, the pounding this took, I'll give you. So I got to the location, and what I found out is that I had a cooler strapped to the back, and it got beat so bad, the bottles broke. Water bottles broke. That's how rough this road was. Water bottles broke, which flat tires are your friend is not true. Flat tires are not your friend. Shane Gorell, what's up, man? How are you doing, man? Good to see you. I hope you're well. Flat tires are not your friend. But yeah, that was our journey. So we went up there and we've got another journey slated, I think, for Friday. And again, when am I going to go? When are we going to be on? I don't know when we're going to be. I mean, I'm not slating anything. I mean, we're just going to do it. I'm going to do another, Lost Highway. I don't know, you know, when the dates are that they're going to come out. So when I can, I'm going to put a show out. And when I can do this, I'm going to put a show out. I know I already have one for next Tuesday for sure. Flat tires make for less bumps. That's true. Well, anyway, my calves were on fire up to today from doing that ride. They had been, I've never experienced the amount of beating in my legs. Man, I ride motocross like a lot of everybody did in dirt bikes. I mean, most everybody here has had that journey. And I'm telling you what, my calves are cracked. And then poor Art, I have a seat post that's got actually a shock on it on this bike. And Art didn't have that. So his calves weren't hurting, but man, his butt had to have been hurting. Jesus. It was brutal. It was brutal. Can't sit down even for a minute. And it did. It roasted us, but it was a gas. I'm going to tell you, it's some of the most fun I've ever had on an adventure. You know, most people, and they're going to tell you this, when you go out, getting to the location, it's just usually just a pain in the ass. It is. You're crawling over rocks. You're hiking in. You're all this stuff that you got to do to get to locations, right? We've all been there. And so what happened was, it was fun going to the slot. It was fun getting to the place. And so I've never experienced that. I've never experienced it being fun getting to the location and then doing it was fun and then getting on the bike. And even though it was rough, it was still a lot of fun to go take the bike. Hey Shane, get a hold of me. We'll put a show together or something. I'll get you back on here. So that's awesome. Glad you found a treasure. We'll get you on here on either a Lost Highway or one of these shows. I'll get with you later, but we'll get something. I have a battery issue with that bike, so we took the other bike. But you know, I bought that bike originally to go do that. And I will tell you this. You can get by on a cheaper bike if you're not. I mean, this place that we went, the road to hell, this is not the place to go with that bike. I'm going to be the first to tell you that. But other than this, it wasn't bad. I mean, you know, I'm learning on what I needed, how I need to do it, and how I need to put these things together. I got the perfect example of how and what I'm going to do these bikes to get them out there to do what they want. But it was a gas. It really was. It was a ton of fun, and we had a hell of a good time, and it was cool. It really was. I don't blame you, Lovey Pirate. A big seat is a good seat. You don't look for cool when you're riding these bikes. You look for whatever saves your ass, because it is brutal. And then, you know, I didn't have the suspension bike to take out there. So we took the non-suspension bike, but it did, you know, it actually, I was pretty happy with it. It actually performed as good as I wanted, you know, could expect it to. And we're going to take it on another journey this week and see which way it goes. But, again, I appreciate everybody. And, thank you for hanging out with me. Go Suns. And, Shane, give me an email a little later and we'll get something lined up and we'll get something put on here and we'll have some fun with it. Some fun with some treasures. So, man, everybody have a good evening. Thanks for the support, Don. I appreciate you. You always take care of me and thank you very much. And I will talk to you guys later. Have a great evening and, let's wind it back up.
Side am I on? What side am I supposed to be on? I never know.
Amigos, everybody have a great week. Go Suns. Put some W's in the columns and let's have a great evening. And I appreciate everybody. If you can give me a thumbs up, I'd appreciate it. Have a good one. I'll see you later.